Good morning again to all of our parishioners who are at home and who are friends and families who are gathered to watch the live streaming Mass this morning. We realize the last couple of days the heat has been quite hot at home, and some of you may find very uncomfortable, and some of you may not have air conditioning in your home. We hope that you will find some relief, some comfort maybe, by just by walking outside for a while and come back. As you know, when you walk outside, if you can, please wear a mask, as it's being recommended and required by some cities, just for safe precautionary measures. Where do you meet Jesus in your life? Where do you meet the risen Christ? And where do we meet the risen Christ as Catholic Christians? And where do we allow the risen Jesus to meet us? Because that is the whole story since the day of Jesus' resurrection. Jesus has come to meet different people, the woman of Jerusalem, the disciples, and now to the disciples here on the road to the Emmaus. And so it allows us to kind of pause as we celebrate the risen Jesus Christ. It kind of helps us to ask ourselves, where do we allow Jesus to meet us during this time of the pandemic? Pope Francis this morning on the Sunday Mass, he defined who is a Christian in this whole context of our encounter with Jesus. And this is what he has to say. A Christian is a person because he or she has met Jesus and has allowed Jesus to meet them. And that the Lord Jesus interacts with us in such the same way that he interacts with the disciples on the road to Emmaus. And so where do we meet Jesus Christ in your life? It's so important. So where do we allow Jesus to meet us? It's also an important part of our openness of faith. Courage of faith. And so I'm going to give you some steps to recognize a possibility where you may meet Jesus. Rebellion, resentment, as I presented to you on Easter Sunday, recovery, reconciliation, or redemption. But before we identify, maybe today just God, the way that Jesus meets us, and we meet Jesus, is part of our rebellious way of life. So last Sunday on Divine Mercy, we come to explore four areas: being helpful, helpless, merciful, but we are not called to be merciless. And those many of those four areas, we can meet the risen Jesus and allow the risen Jesus to meet us. Whether when we are feel helpful with others, when we feel helpless in this whole situation, because we are so young, so immature, not having a job, or we feel merciful for people who are seniors, homebound, with great disabilities. But we are called not to be merciful. So I proposed a question last Sunday, and the question was this. It's also the same question that being presented in the recent survey this past week by Pew Research Center is which patients should hospital prioritize for critical care if ventilators are in short supply? Which patients should hospitals prioritize for critical care if ventilators are in short supply? It's a moment examination of ourselves being merciful or being merciless. A moment to examine between medicine and moral ethics come into play. So the two scenarios we present in this way. Patient most in need at the moment, which may mean fewer people overall, survive the doctor do not. Deny treatment based on age or health status. So immediate needs, everyone get a ventilator. The other option is patient more likely to recover, which may mean more people survive, but that some patients don't receive treatment because they are older and sicker. So which side are you on? People who are most needed of medical treatment and survivorship for ventilators at the moment, or people who may need the ventilators more because their chances of survivorship is higher. So where is your decision in this moment of dilemma? Where you may come to see yourself being helpful, being helpless, or being merciful, or being merciless. So the survey by Pew Research came out this past week, and it shows two categories. It identified affiliated, those who have faith, who believe in God. The unaffiliated, those who are atheists, agnostic, have nothing in particular. So the first group, the affiliated, the Catholic Christians, the Protestants, the Anglican, so we fare, say, 56% over 39%. The 56% say patients who are in need of medical assistance, they should get ventilators immediately. And the second party of the groups at 39%. So these are the affiliated people with faith. So the non-affiliated or the unaffiliated said, no, 41% of people should only deserve immediate needs, medical needs with ventilators. And 56%, they say, let those who have higher possibility to survive get the ventilators. So the unaffiliated have resulted in what we call it a eukaryotic ethics. A eukaryotic ethics, which is based on outcomes, which is based on consequences. Disregard for the immediate needs of age or seriousness of health and recovery. So which side are you taking on at this moment? Allowing people with ventilators to have higher chance to survive, or allow anyone who's in need at the moment to use the ventilators. So none of us, and we are, should not be based as Catholic Christians on this utilitarianism model of ethical behaviors. Because we're not just all about outcomes and results, but we're also all about the dignity of the human person, the age, the seriousness of the health in that given moment in time. And so let us re-examine that whole journey where we allow Jesus to meet us and allow us to meet Jesus in those critical moments where, especially when our healthcare workers have to make those determinations. So let us pray for them. Let us pray that their faith too will inform them to make a better decision. Who will get the ventilators and who will not get the ventilators? So I go back with you again. Where do we meet Jesus? I want to focus with you on this rebellious mentality that we may have. And it's all in all of us. Especially in these recent weeks or these recent days where we see a lot of people with their flags demonstrating on the street in their rebellious ways of looking at things, disagreeing with the stay-at-home orders, saying that I want my freedom, right? Even if it means death. So I want business to be open. So people may argue, I want the economy back early and soon so that I can also go back to my work so that my business will not close. So where do we then re-examine that rebellious way of our own thinking? So let's explore what is that rebellious or rebel's effectiveness in all of us. So there are two types of rebellious way of thinking. The first is rebellion of non-conformity. Rebellion of non-conformity against social fitting in. Non-conformity is something that we all go through. In our own life, I don't want to dress the same way as other people dress. I want to be different. I want to grow up in the same culture, speak the same language, and have the same accent. And the second type, we would call it rebellion of non-compliance against adult authority. What children we go rebellious within and rebel upon us. So inside all of us, we have that innate nature that we want to rebel within ourselves. We want to change what society is doing. And some people can change that in the most creative way. Einstein rebelled the nature of theory of physics that changed everything, of relativity. Look at Apple founders, look at Macintosh founders, look at IBM founders, look at whatever Microsoft founders. In their own rebellious within of their own creativity, they're able to change society in a way that is incredibly powerful. And that's a rebellious within all of us. But there's also rebellious among us at work, at church, in families, where this in the group environment, this person, this individual able to transform how business are doing, how people changing their philosophical way of treating one another. So in a rebellious way, there are positive, there's also negative, being constructive or unconstructive. So re-examine yourself. Am I rebellion within? Am I rebellion among other people? So part of the journey here, then let us go back to the scriptures, what we read in Peter. He talks about the word redemption. But maybe part of that redemption is found in himself. That his own rebellion within is that he denied Jesus Christ. So now as he beginning to become a rebellious among his apostles, to become that central voice, to become the rock of the church, and so he stood here in this letter writing to his community, as he proclaimed here in the second reading. He said, "You were ransomed from your futile conduct." What does that mean? Futile conduct. It means your life is decaying slowly every day. Handed on by your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with precious blood of Christ, as a spotless, unblemished lamb. Jesus was known from the foundations of the world, but revealed in the final time for you, who through him believed in God, who raised him from the dead, and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. So there is that rebellion within of Peter, but he acknowledged what he has done wrong and transformed the church among him to help people to see that there is faith and hope that I am God because of Jesus Christ. And that is such an important part of our journey when we examine this whole global pandemic. Where is my rebellious to non-compliance or to non-conformity of my own life and of my own faith? And it's also a challenge to every priest, to every leaders of the church. Where do we draw the line between persecution and non-persecution to stand in Christ? And where do we see conformity with policies of government that's in alignment and not in alignment with our teaching? And that is such an important part of our journey, but we have to bring Jesus Christ into the picture, because otherwise it's all about me. It's all about us. And we have lose sight of what it means to meet Jesus along the way. Even if we are debating, even if we are discussing about ourselves with different points, different perspectives of life, Jesus can change that. Here, through the breaking of the scriptures and the breaking of the bread, the disciples recognizing each other through Jesus Christ. So I could be further developing this whole rebellious mentality that is in all of us, or what I call the rebel effects. Christian movement, who head of this organization called Happiness Project, she wrote a book in 2017 with a title called Better Than Before. Better Than Before. She identified areas of people with a rebellious behaviors and mentalities. And she said in her book this way, habits are the invisible architectures of daily life. We repeat about 40% of our behavior almost daily. If we change our habits, we change our life. We've got 40% of our behaviors are repetitive. Going to bed, getting up, having breakfast, and nowadays your children sleeping in, and we try to get them up and change that habit because class is happening. And yet half the time I see when our students CCS, they have their hood on.
But it is in this deep part of our journey of faith that where we need to look.
happens to reread the scriptures today, as the disciples, too, in their own way, a moment of encounter with Jesus in the road to Emmaus, as they sit down with Jesus Christ, and this miraculous journey happened, they urge Jesus, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening, and the day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them, and it happened that, while he was with them at table, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them. With that, their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. Just because they invited Jesus to stay with them. And the same is true with all of us who have that rebellious mentality, whether it's within or with among one another. Let us find a sense of identity of faith with Jesus Christ, identity of clarity in our own strategy of where we are, our own conveniences at your home, for me here, and wherever it may we find and turn that sense of that frustration, that rebellious way, to truly deeply to bring about the safety and recovery of health for all of us during this whole pandemic. It's just not just about you, about me, it's for the whole world.